asked my exclusive interview with the biggest music star you may not have heard of, but you should. He's 6-time Grammy nominee, Bruno Mars. Tonight I ask him the questions few others have dared to put to him. What's the worst song you've ever written? If I could take away the money or the women, which would you rather keep?
Definitely the women here.
What kind of question is that? What is this, a setup?
Bruno Mars, the man, his music, probably the biggest pop star in the world right now. This is Piers Morgan Tonight. Take care, Rob. All the best.
Thank you. Bye.
Coming up, the singer-songwriter who is half Rob Lowe's age and twice as good-looking and one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people on the planet. And he's pretty popular with the ladies too, certainly more popular than my last guest. So that's Bruno Mars.
There's not a thing that I would change, cause you're amazing, just the way you are.
I switched venues to the rather more glamorous Avalon Club in Hollywood, and I found somebody even more glamorous than Rob Lowe, and that is Bruno Mars. Bruno, welcome.
Good to be here.
It's going to really eat away at Rob Lowe. That's you're damn. Younger, you're better looking.
That's my goal in life.
More talented.
Mr. Lowe.
Now listen, you tweeted, I thought 2010 was a great year, but thanks to you guys, 2011 has been the greatest year of my life. Why?
For many reasons. I toured the world this year. I've been to places that I never dreamt of going, singing these songs and promoting my album, and got a tremendous response. It's funny, that day I tweeted that, I bought my mother a house.
Really?
Yeah, and it's thanks to these fans.
Was that a dream of yours to do that?
Absolutely. She's been taking care of me for quite some time. It's time for her to sit back and relax.
How did she react when you did that?
She said, it's not big enough, get me out of there. No, she was in tears. It was a very special moment for me, so.
The thing I like about your story is it hasn't all just been easy. A lot of entertainers your age, it all goes crazy very young, and then it just carries on, and then it burns out. In your case, you had this big wake-up call. You were 18 years old, you come to Hollywood, Motown signed you up, and you thought, whoa.
This is it.
I have arrived.
Yep.
I, Bruno Mars, am a Motown sensation. And then boom, almost as fast as you got it, they dropped you. How did that feel, that time in your life?
It was taking a step back. I used to be able to walk into a room and say, hey, I'm Bruno Mars, I'm signed with Motown Records. And then now I have to say, I got dropped from Motown Records. You lose leverage, you lose people believing in you because they go, why didn't it work?
How did you get told the news?
It was like this, hey, we don't want you anymore.
As brutal as that?
It wasn't as brutal as that. And you know what? It's not Motown's fault. I was too young. I didn't know what it was like. I knew I could sing. I knew I could sing, but there's so much more that I had to learn. I didn't come from the recording background. I came from doing live shows and performing with bands, and that was my craft. I didn't know what it took to be, you know, to become, to record, be a recording artist. Now, okay, now you got to write songs. Now you got to establish who you are. I don't know if anyone knows who they are at 18 years old.
Would you react well, or like most 18-year-olds who get...
I'm going to cry. I'm going to shed some tears.
did a part of you believe that maybe you weren't good enough?
You definitely have those nights where you feel a little insecure, but I didn't want to give up. I wasn't going to go... My goal was, I'm not going to go back home. I'm not going to go back to Hawaii and face my friends and my family saying it didn't pan out. I got to do something.
What did you change about what you were doing? How did you move from has been at 18 to back on track?
I think I grew. I grew as an artist. I grew as a writer. I wrote songs every day. I started producing. And, you know, practice is what you need. And I've written a lot of awful songs, and I'm, you know, hopefully...
What's the worst song you've ever written?
Oh, I don't even want to say it.
It's the one that makes you shiver.
It's CNN, come on.
Come on, for CNN worldwide audience, the worst Bruno Mars song you have ever written, the one that even now makes you come out in a weird sweat.
Me and my partner Phil wrote a song called Bedroom Bandit. That's all I have to say. That's all I have to say.
I can't even imagine how bad those lyrics are.
But I promise you, Pierce, had you been in the studio, we thought we were going to win 18 Grammys off this song. We thought it was the cool. And then the next day, we called each other up, like, what were we thinking?
You told a good story that I read about you when you were talking about Elvis Presley and a bit of footage you'd seen of him performing, I think, on a TV show with a big audience of women. And there was a moment when Elvis spotted that the girls were going really crazy. So rather than doing what most guys do, which is speed up,
right,
get to the moment,
right,
he slowed it all down.
That's right. How
everything went into slow motion.
I think it was the Milton Berle show. I think it was the Milton Berle show. Or I don't know if it's Ed Sullivan, but he sang Hound Dog. And he had him. He had the girls with the palm of his hand. And
just,
I remember,
by slowing down.
And he said, you know what, watch this. And you could tell that it was like an improv thing because the band kind of didn't know what to do. And I don't know if that was live TV or not, but as soon as he started, he milked it for everything it was worth. And I remember being a kid watching that and saying, I want that. I want girls to scream like that.
Well, now they do, Bruno. In sickening
numbers. That's right, Rob Bowe, you hear that?
In numbers only Rob Lowe could dream about. What is the reality of being a heartthrob?
The heartthrob? Oh,
yeah.
Man.
Don't do the usual.
Oh,
no,
come
me,
on.
A heartthrob? Me?
Bruno, not me.
Really? Me? No, you're kidding me. Let's come through all that crap, shall
we? Okay, so what's the question?
Do you plead guilty to being a heartthrob?
I definitely don't plead guilty to being a heartthrob. I don't think my friends will ever let me say that I'm a heartthrob. They keep me clean.
Some mornings look in the mirror.
And I say, yeah, you are the most beautiful man I've ever seen. But that's just me, Pierce.
This is a stupid question, but when you look out now and you see a sea of beautiful women screaming at you,
what else is new?
It's got to feel good, right? How good does it feel? Is it actually a bit weird?
It's the greatest feeling on earth. You can't deny that. What do you mean? Like I said, I don't know if it's a sea of women. It's fun. It's fun.
It's a little break. I want to talk to you when we come back about your early life in Hawaii, the time before this craziness was going on, and also how you felt about Time magazine putting you in their 100 most influential people of the year, because that's quite an accolade. Four-year-old Bruno, tomorrow's king of rock and roll, the world's youngest Elvis impersonator, Bruno. My special guest, Bruno Mars. But Bruno, that's you as a four-year-old doing your Elvis impression. You were good. I mean, you were good little Elvis, weren't you?
Man, I see those. I don't remember that. I can't remember doing that. I don't even remember. I don't even think I knew what I was doing, that I was actually impersonating somebody else.
I see your parents say that unlike the other kids in the family who were quite shy when it actually came to performing on stage, you loved it. You wanted to be there. You wanted to be little Elvis running around. Is that true? Do you remember that part of it?
Yeah, I remember one night I had 100-some-odd fever, and I was about 6 years old, something like that, and my mother wouldn't let me perform, and I was bawling all night up in the room, and I had to call in sick that night, and I couldn't get to put my jumpsuit on, and I was just crying. That's the one thing I remember.
What was early life for you and the family like in Hawaii?
Hawaii is a special place. And because when I think about my childhood, I think about my family, my sisters, and my brother, us going to the beach, doing things that you would think a family that grew up from Hawaii would do. But, you know, my father, who put this show together, where you see the little Elvis clips, you know, he had this show 6 nights a week at Sheraton Waikiki. So it was me going to school, and then at nighttime, I turned into Batman.
And what values did they instill in you?
Just family is everything for us. I wouldn't be where I am today without support and the love that my parents gave me and the knowledge that my father gave me, because he's the one that put me on to music. He's the one that that showed me Jackie Wilson, James Brown, and Elvis.
What kind of advice did he give your dad? Because he's putting you into a business he knew well. It can be a rough business. It can be a lonely place.
Yeah.
It can be a place, as you discovered at 18, can be full of great highs and full of terrible lows.
Right. His advice, you see, my dad was a showman. My mom's the singer in the family. My dad was kind of the leader as far as putting shows together and finding guys that could sing and doing this doo-wop stuff. That was the show that we were in. It was called the Love Note Show. And my dad has this love for 1950s doo-wop music. So he knows that he's not the best singer in the world, but he knows he can find the best singers in the world and put them all together on a stage and make magic happen. And that's what he did with this. And I think as far as like my father was like leadership qualities, and that's what he showed me.
How do they feel, your family, when Time Magazine, one of the most prestigious publications in the world, comes out with its famous annual list of the 100 most influential people in the world, and you're on that list, and you're sharing this with people like Benjamin Netanyahu, Barack Obama, Mark Zuckerberg, General David Petraeus, and Justin Bieber. So you aren't the only heartthrob cracked in the list, but that's a big moment, isn't it? I mean, that's a moment that recognizes not just you as a performer, but as a businessman and as a young man with real influence over millions of people.
I guess. Proud. I think my mother and father are just extremely proud, you know, but to them, I'll always be little Bruno. And that's what I need. Doing what I do, I need my family, and I need to go back home and feel like I'm safe and everything's cool.
If I could take away the money or the women, which would you rather keep?
Definitely the women, Pierce.
What kind of question is that? What is this, a setup?
Don't you take away my women, please. Don't you do that to me.
You take all the money away.
Take all the money.
All the cars, the house. Let me think about this, Bruno.
Yeah.
This is a big question.
I'm good.
Does the money, in the end, mean that much? It's obviously great to have it, but does it mean that much to you?
No, I'm not doing. Of course, the like I said, you know, being able to buy my mom a house, I mean, that's something awesome that I've always wanted to do, but I don't think, if you're doing music for money, then I don't know if you can be taken seriously.
I mean, you've been involved with songs about desperately wanting to be a billionaire.
And that's the beauty about Billionaire. If you listen to the lyrics of it, it's really not about, it is, we touch on it a little bit, but why I wrote Billionaire, when I was flat broke. I just helped write a song for Flo Rida. It was the number one song in the world, biggest downloads ever. It was the number one song for I don't know how many weeks. It broke records, and I was flat broke. I can explain all that. It works differently for songwriters. Songwriters, you have to work, you have to wait for residuals, you have to pray that the song's gonna be a hit, and then a year later, you might get a check.
You'll see this song go around the world.
Yeah.
Massive, huge international hit. And you're making nothing.
And I can't buy a sandwich.
Literally?
Literally.
No. What do you think brings happiness?
The simple things. Little things in life.
Hold that.
Okay.
Let's come back after the break. I want you to think carefully.
Okay.
I want the Bruno Mars secret recipe to happiness.
But you won't do the same.